Good afternoon, one and all, and welcome to another session of Let's Get On With The Exams. For today's session, we'll have Dr. Usha, who is our consultant in Orbit and Oculoplasty at Shimoga. Dr. Usha will be taking the session on evaluation of proptosis and how exactly you should go about in your exams when you see such a case. Over to you, Dr. Usha.
Thank you, sir. Sorry for the delay. In today's session, I'll be talking about how to evaluate a case of a proptosis based on a case scenario. So the case given to me is a young adult with a history of proptosis over 1 year. So what are the differential diagnoses I can consider in a young adult with a history of proptosis over 1 year? So if it is a unilateral proptosis, in orbit, any lesion in the orbit can be categorized into five, you can categorize in terms of five things, like whether it is an infection or an inflammation, neoplasm or vascular lesions and structural. So is it going to be an infection? Definitely no, because a patient cannot have infection for over a 1 year. Infection is something very acute. So you cannot think in terms of infection. Second one is an inflammation. Yes, it can be an inflammation. And the most important one in a unilateral, by and large, in any case of unilateral, the first differential diagnosis should be a thyroid orbitopathy. And then you can even consider some of the specific inflammatory conditions like Sjogren's and other vasculitis like vaginous granulomatosis. You can consider, but in a young adult, it is again a query. It is not that common. And yes, non-specific inflammations are quite common, and we'll have to rule out the this condition. The third one is a neoplasm. Though neoplasm in this young adult is rare, you can expect some of the lesions. For example, a lymphoproliferative, though it is seen in our elderly, there are cases which is reported in young adults. And when you come to a neurological cause, schwannomas, either an intraconal schwannoma or an extraconal can present in this age group, though it is commonly seen in middle age. Because meningiomas are commonly seen in middle age around 40 years, but there are cases which are presented in 30 years and 20 to 30 years. And then vascular lesion, yes, it can be a cavernous hemangioma, can present in a young adult. Secondaries, very rare, but you cannot excluded. And vascular lesions like veno-lymphatic malformations can also present in a young adult over 1 year, but they have this waxing and waning symptoms. And the last one is a structural. Orbital dermoid can also present as a unilateral proptosis in a young adult. So what if it is bilateral? A bilateral infection, definitely no. Thyroid, yes, bilateral thyroid can be one of the most important cause. And then you have to rule out some of the non-specific inflammations. And lymphoma, though rare, bilateral lymphomas can present. So coming to the history. So history is very important in any evaluation of proptosis. So the patient can present as either a prominence or a displacement of globe, or they can have a palpable mass. In either condition, you should always emphasize on the onset, duration, and course of the disease, and also its variation with the posture. For example, any case which has acute onset and short duration, and which is worsening without any postural changes, you should always think in terms of some acute conditions like inflammation or any long-standing lesion which is presented with acute bleed. A pre-existing lesion which is presenting as an acute bleed can develop as an acute symptoms. And supposing if the patient is having a long-standing symptoms, but which is progressive over a period of a year, which has a very slow progression, you should always think in terms of benign. Sometimes a lesion can be present for over a period of time and suddenly it is progressing, it is worsening. You should always think it could be a malignant lesion. And then the second symptom, most common symptom is pain. So pain, again, you should describe in terms of onset, site, type, and whether it is aggravating with any eye movements. So for example, any acute sharp pain, which is very severe and which aggravates with eye movements, you should always think in terms of inflammatory conditions. And sometimes you can have even a dull, aching, boring pain in the eye. And that you should, again, thyroid presence like that. And sometimes you can find a mass or a prominence of the globe, which is painless, that indicates that something is benign. So you'll have to investigate for that. And the third symptom, which is most commonly seen, is diplopia. So why does a diplopia occur? Because when there is a misalignment in the visual axis, you get diplopia. So in which all conditions you can get diplopia? Either there should be a mechanical limitation, a mass within the intraconal or extraconal, which is limiting the extraocular movements, or it is pushing the globe away and thereby misaligning the visual axis, you can get diplopia. Or if there is infiltration into the nerve, a neurological paralysis can cause diplopia that you should elicit. And also, whenever you're taking a history of diplopia, you should identify whether there is a horizontal separation or a vertical separation of images, and in which gaze, whether the diplopia is in a primary gaze or in the extreme gaze, or if it is present in all gazes, has to be elicited. And whether it is intermittent, it goes off with the blinking, that has to be noted. The other next important symptom is the visual loss. So visual loss, again, you should describe in terms of onset, progression, and its relationship with the proptosis. So again, a patient can have acute loss of vision, which is sudden and complete loss of vision. It indicates that there is a compromise, vascular compromise. And again, if a patient is having a loss of vision, which is progressively increasing, you can think in terms that a lesion is compressing the optic nerve. You get a clue out of it. Again, a vision loss, a patient having a vision loss in relation with proptosis, whether the proptosis has developed first and followed by it progressively, there is a loss of vision. Again, you can think like a tumor which is slowly compressing the nerve or slowly infiltrating into the nerve, it gives a clue in it. Suppose if the person is having initially noticed there is a vision loss, followed by that there is a minimal or no proptosis, then you can think that the lesion can be of neural origin, the optic nerve origin. And then you should also rule out other symptoms like swelling of the eyelid, whether there is redness, watering, photophobia. This again gives a indication that there is some acute inflammation going on. And if there is a photophobia, watering, redness, again, there could be a corneal compromise. And always you should elicit a history of trauma, and a presence of any other swelling elsewhere in the body has to be documented. And then you should always give importance to the past history, like pertaining to orbit, like orbital diseases. In case of systemic, you should always elicit a status of diabetes. And if the patient is a known thyroid, or if they have any systemic malignancies and they have undergone treatment for it, and any previous histories of mastectomy, thyroidectomy, any thyroid surgeries and nasal surgeries has to be elicited. And when coming to the personal history, you should rule out the person is a smoker, or if there is progressive loss of weight loss, is important to give a clue for the diagnosis. And then, so the support history. So we'll go to the physical examination. Grossly, the physical examination is categorized into a general assessment or a psychophysical assessment, and then a detailed ocular examination. So a general assessment. So in a general assessment, as a routine procedure, we have to look for the head posture, whether there is a head tilt or a face turn with a particular side, and then if there is a chin elevation or chin depression, that has to be noted. And ocular posture, whether the visual axis is symmetrical, that has to be documented. And in our orbital diseases, the facial asymmetry is very important, because we have to know the facial contours. Because sometimes, by looking at this, you can rule out if the patient is having any facial nerve palsy or any other congenital bony abnormalities. can be noted. And then moving on to the psychophysical examination, the visual acuity, color vision, and the visual fields. These three are very important to identify whether there is a vascular or a neural compromise. So whenever there is a sudden loss of vision and things, it indicates that there is a vascular compromise. And over a progressive loss of vision, you can even it goes in favor of a neural involvement. So these three gives a clue about a vascular and the optic nerve compromise. And moving on to ocular examination. So the ocular examination, the first thing what we'll have to look into our ocular examination is eyelids. So normally the position of the eyelids is important. Normally the upper eyelid covers about 2 mm of the upper part of the cornea, and the lower eyelid just touches the limbus. So this position should be documented and it has to be followed, especially in case of thyroid. You need to document it for the further progression of the disease, whether the disease is progressing. To know the prognosis, we need to document it. And and next thing you'll have to go is for the fullness. You should look for the fullness or edema of the lids. So in this picture, you can see there is a fullness here. And in fullness in any particular quadrant has to be documented. And whenever you see an edema, you should document whether the edema is involving the preseptal, pretarsal, or it is involving both, and whether it is involving either upper or lower lid has to be documented, and that will be given a grades. And the next thing is, after looking at the lid margin and edema or fullness in the lids, you should move on to whether there is redness in the any ingestion of the eyelid, and that should be noted. This indicates that there could be some acute activity, infection, inflammation, which is acute going on. And then other thing what you have to see in the lids is lag of thalamus. Ask the patient to close the lids gently and document the amount of lag of thalamus. And also you should ask the patient to close with a forceful closure of the eyelid. In that case also you have to document the lag of thalamus. And again, proceeding with the eyelid margin, you should measure the intermarginal distance, the palpable fissure height when the patient is looking at a distance. And you should measure the MRD 1 and 2. And also, if there is a scleral show, you should measure how much of the scleral show is seen in both the superior and inferior part of the sclera. And if it is a thyroid case, you should definitely mention few thyroid signs like dull wrinkles, Stellwag, and Mobius, and von Graffis has to be mentioned. If not at least everything, at least few signs has to be mentioned. And that was the first part. You should, after you examine the eyelid, you will have to move on to the orbit. So orbit or a proptosis. So again, examination of the orbit will be in terms of inspection, palpation, auscultation. So in inspection, as I already mentioned, you should look for whether there is fullness in the eyelid in any particular quadrant has to be documented. And after this, you will have to identify whether there is whether the patient is having a proptosis or it is a pseudoproptosis. How do you do that? There are two methods. One is a worm's eye view and the other one is a Knapp-Seegers. How do you do this? Worm's eye, I'll show you, play a video. So here the patient comfortably sits in a table, on a chair, and then you will have to bend the patient's head backward and you will have to examine from below. So in this case, you should see whichever eye is seen most prominent has to be noted. So this indicates that eye is having a proptosis. And the other method is Knapsiger's method, where you stand behind the patient and slightly tilt the head end of the patient, and you should see from superior part. That is, you should focus on the superior orbital rim, and normally the eyelid is just seen at the level of the rim. Something is above, beyond this, it indicates that there is proptosis. So this is a gross methods to identify whether there is a proptosis or not. And once you are done with proptosis, you should identify whether there is a pseudo, whether it is a pseudo proptosis. So you should elicit other conditions. You should rule out other conditions of pseudo proptosis like myopia, bophthalmos, and other eye ptosis. And if there is ipsilateral lid retraction, it indicates, it falsely gives the impression of proptosis. So this has to be ruled out. So now you have, you know that there is a proptosis. The second thing, the third thing, what you will have to do is whether the proptosis is unilateral or bilateral should be noted. So once there is a proptosis and you are documented unilateral or bilateral, next thing you should see is whether it is a axial proptosis or a eccentric proptosis. So how do you do this is by Hirschberg's corneal reflex. So in this image, when you see the visual axis is not aligned, it indicates that there is some eccentricity of this side. So this is a eccentric proptosis. But whereas in this, the visual axis are in align. So this indicate, but the eye looks proptosed. So this is a axial proptosis. And once you're done with that, you should look for any visible pulsations seen in the eye. So that indicates whether there is some vascular, it indicates there is it indicates the possibility of a vascular lesions. And after it is done, you should also examine whether the proptosis changes with the position. So for that, you will have to do a maneuvers like Valsalva maneuver or a head bend. You should ask the patient to bend the head. So here in this video, I'll demonstrate how to do a Valsalva maneuver. So here the patient sits comfortably and asked to hold his nose and mouth and to breathe against a closed glottis. So ask the patient basically to hold the breath and then measure the proptosis. The second method is you ask the patient to bend down and place his head between his legs and wait for 30 seconds. Then after that, you will have to measure the proptosis. This measurement can indicate by doing a Valsalva maneuver, it indicates that it could be some vascular lesion, like by holding the breath, you're thereby increasing the venous congestion into the orbit and it increases the proptosis. So once you elicit this, you'll have to look the skin over the lesion. There can be erythema or any pulsations, as I mentioned, and there can be any pigmentation. So in inspection, you will have to look for the eyelid, the lid margin, and its measurements, some of the measurements, and then you should identify whether there is a proptosis, rule out pseudoproptosis, and then whether it is a unilateral or bilateral. And finally, you should look for whether it is an axial or a eccentric proptosis. Then you should do some of the maneuvers like Valsalva and head bending procedures, and then look for the skin around the swelling or a lesion, any swelling or lesion in the orbit. So this ends the inspection. So now let's move on to palpation. So in palpation, whenever you find a local mass, you'll have to look for if there is any local rise of temperature. It indicates that there is some inflammation going on. and also whether it is whether there is a tenderness has to be elicited. If you find a localized mass in any part of the orbit, then you should always mention it in terms of location, which where exactly it is located, and the size of the lesion with approximate dimensions using your ruler, and then you should tell the surface margin and its extent, whether the whether it's extending into the orbit and you're not able to make out any posterior extensions, whether it is defined, the definition has to be given, and then you should look for the consistency, whether it is cystic, soft or firm mass, then you try to compress the lesion and elicit compressibility. And once you do that, then you should go for a finger insinuation test, that is between the a bone and the orbit, and a mass, if it is present, has to be looked into. I mean, you should try to insinuate a finger to rule out any mass or lesions. And after doing that, you will have to do a retropulsion test. By doing a retropulsion test, it gives a rough clue whether there is an intracondral mass and it's exerting a firm pressure, or if it is compressible, it indicates that there is some vascular lesion which is compressed. So after this, you will have to look for the bruit, and bruit is examined by using the bell of the stethoscope. I'll show a short video. So now, I mentioned, this is an abzygous method where you look for the prominence of the bro, and you see the globe is well away from the superior orbital rim. So this indicates that there is a proptosis. So inspection, you can see the fullness in both the upper eyelid and lower eyelid. And ask the patient, this is a case of a thyroid, so elicit some of the thyroid signs. See, the patient is unable to converge. And when asked to elevate, there is absence of bro, and elicit the resistance. So this resistance, retropulsion, resistance retropulsion can be elicited by using the thumb or by using the index and the middle finger. And then, see, never you should insert the finger like this, because you should always ask the patient. So whichever quadrant you're palpating, ask the patient to look in that direction, and then insert a little finger or the index finger. And palpate the entire quadrant, I mean the entire orbit, between the rim and the globe, or if there is a mass between the mass, rim and the globe. This is because to identify whether the mass is extending from the orbit or if it is evolving from the globe, that has to be, and to know the extension, this should be done. And again, look for all the eye movements. And so on. So this is with the examination of the orbit or a proptosis. Now once you're done with that, you'll have to look in for, you should document the amount of the proptosis. So how much proptosis is present. In case if it is an axial proptosis, there are various instruments to measure, but the most common ones which we are using are the Hertel's loops, and if both are not present, then you can use a ruler. So this is a Hertel's exophthalmometer where you have a groove and you have a mirror here, and then inside you have a scale, and this is the reading which is used to measure the basal height, so that every subsequent visits you can measure the the same basal height can be used for subsequent reading, especially in case of proptosis. You can, it gives an information. and it also helps in progression of the, to identify the progression of the disease, and it also gives the exact measurement. So each time when you're trying to change the basal height, the measurements will be erroneous. So this basal height becomes important. So in each visits, you will have to maintain the same basal height for recording of proptosis. And this is a Lutz exophthalmometer where you have a reading scale on both the sides, and there is a plastic rod in between with a removable scale on the one, with a scale fixed on one side, with a scale which can be removed on the other side. Similarly, in a Hertel's, you have this part which can be moved ahead and forward, I mean, which inward and outward to adjust the height. I'll show a video how to measure using a Hertel's exophthalmometer. So again, here it has a mirror on both sides, and inside there is a scale, and this is the basal height, and this can be moved, adjusted so that it can move inside and out to adjust the basal height. So it has a groove on either end. So the groove has to be placed on the lateral orbital rim. So once it is placed, adjust on the other side. The other side of the scale has to be placed on the other orbital rim. And then once you're done with this, set the basal height. Then always ask the patient to look straight. And that is, the right eye should look into the left eye of the examiner. Each time, only one, I mean, at a time, only one eye should be examined. So supposing you're examining the left eye, the patient has to look into the right eye of the examiner in order to maintain the, in order to maintain the error of moving the eye in and out. So this has a mirror, I already mentioned. So the eye, the reflection of the eye, that is from the orbit to the apex of the cornea, will fall on this mirror. And this will fall on the scale here. So you can see here, you can see a white part, and then you can see the apex of the cornea. So this gives the measurement. So from here, based on the corneal reflex, you can document the amount of proptosis. So in order to avoid the parallax error, there are two lines which are present here. One is your red and one is a black area behind. So this has to be aligned to avoid the parallax error. So after Hertel's, so there is another instrument called Lutz. So I'll play a video. So this is the Lutz, which has a two scales on two scales, plastic scales, and this is a plastic rod. So there are a measure markings on both the scale. There are on the scales. So on both the scales there are markings, and this has a groove to fit into the lateral orbital rim, and other end can be easily it is detachable. Next video. Again, I'll fit for the lateral orbital rim. Place the exophthalmometer, the groove of the exophthalmometer on the lateral orbital rim. So adjust the height, ask the patient to look straight. The other scale has to be fit into it. So now there are readings on both the sides. So this reading, so for example, the 20 has to correspond with the 20 of the other. The 30 mark has to correspond with the 30 of the other. So this is done to avoid the parallax, and the reading is measured from the lateral side. That is from the orbital rim. You should look into the apex of the cornea and document the prognosis. That's from the rim to the apex of the cornea. You'll have to record it. After this, you have, if both Hertel's and Lutz are not present, then you will have to use a ruler where the one end of the ruler has to be placed at the level of the lateral orbital rim and measure the proptosis from the rim to the apex of the cornea. You will have to measure it. So now the measurement, the exophthalmometry can be either absolute, relative, or comparative. So this measurement value of proptosis varies with age, race, and gender. So depending on that, there are different values given, but it is, for all practical purpose, it is considered as 16 plus or minus 2 standard deviation. So it is from 12 to 21. So this absolute indicates a value, if the measurement, it can be called as absolute proptosis when you take it from a normal value, that is more than 21. And relative is you compare with the, it is in relation to the other eye. So you compare it with the other eye. So difference of two, if it, different of both the, difference of both the eyes, if it is more than two, it indicates relative. And comparative is over a serial follow-up of the same patient, of the same eye, you will, you can document that there is a proptosis, ongoing increase in the proptosis. And the severity, it is graded as mild, moderate, severe. Something between 21 and 23 is mild. 24 to 27 is moderate. More than 28 is severe. that has to be mentioned in proptosis. I mean, when you're writing the diagnosis, provisional diagnosis, you'll have to mention that. And the next thing is you'll have to, that was in a axial proptosis. So till now what we saw was in the axial proptosis. Supposing if there is an eccentric proptosis, so what are we supposed to do? How do we measure it? How do we measure the displacement? So there can be a horizontal displacement and a vertical displacement. So how do we do this? I'll show a video. Ask the patient to look forward, and then you place a ruler at the middle of the bridge of the nose. You can mark the marking, and that, and the ruler has to pass through the center of the bridge of the nose, and it should pass through the medial canthi of both the eye. Once it is in level, you should use another ruler to, if there is a superior excess proptosis, then you'll have to measure it in, you should use a scale in the upper. And if there is a inferior eccentric proptosis, you rotate the scale, place it again at the center of the nasal bridge, passing through the medial canthi, and the displacement can be measured using an other ruler. Again, that was a vertical displacement. So in a to know the horizontal displacement, again you would place a ruler at the center of the bridge of the nose. And then the ruler has to pass through the medial canthus. And the patient should look straight. So now you'll have to measure the horizontal displacement from the center of the bridge of the nose up to the nasal limbus. And compare this with the other eye, you will get the difference of it will give you a horizontal displacement. So in an eccentric proptosis, you'll use a two scale method. For horizontal and vertical, you'll have to do the way I showed. And next we'll move on to the extraocular movements. So in extraocular movements, there are various methods to measure the extraocular movements. You can either measure in terms of degrees using the Hirschberg's corneal reflex, or using roughly you can use even prisms, or roughly they use the deviations. They measure the deviation by various by giving the numbers like -4, 1, 2, and 3. So supposing if there is a if the eye is consider this eye movement of adduction. So if the eye is unable to move, if there is the adduction is not possible, the person is not able to move the eye inward. So it indicates that there it grossly says it is a -4, or and if the patient, the extreme movements are not possible, it says it's a -1, and in between it's arbitrarily chosen as -2 and -3. And again, using a prism, you can look for the Hirschberg's reflex, or using the Hirschberg's reflex, if the reflex falls on the center and a patient is not able to move, it indicates there is no movement. If the person is trying to move and he is not able to move, it indicates there is no movement. And if the person, if the reflex is seen at the pupillary margin and the person moves his eye, if it falls on the pupillary margin, it is 15 degrees. And if it is between the pupillary margin and the limbus, it's 30. And if it is at the limbus, it is 45. So complete movement, if the person is having, it indicates that 40 or more than 45. So this is a rough way of measuring the eye movements. And once you're done with the extraocular movements, you'll have to move on to biomicroscopic examination. So in a conjunctiva, you always look for a congestion, whether it is localized or diffuse, or if it is seen extremely at the insertion of the recti muscle, that has to be documented. And again, chemosis. Chemosis has a three grades. A grade 0 to 3. 0 indicates there is no chemosis. And 1, 2, 3, if it is 1, it is the chemosis can be seen up to the gray line. And if it is seen up to the outer lid margin, it is 2. And if it is beyond, the anterior lid margin, it is a grade 3 of chemosis. And once the chemosis is noted, look for presence of any keratinization, which indicates that there is a prolonged exposure. And apart from that, you will have to look out other lesions, like a pink lesion either in the superior or the inferior fornix. It indicates that a conjunctival lymphoma. So a person having a proptosis, you can directly correlate it could be a clinically you could correlate it to be a orbital lymphoma. Then once you examine, look for the dilated episcleral vessels. You can see in this picture. So this indicates that there is some communication. There is arterialization of the episcleral vessel. And after the conjunctiva, the next thing is carencal. Again, carencular swelling has to be noted. And after conjunctiva, you'll have to move on to cornea. Look for the signs of corneal exposure, like exposure keratopathy, like epithelial erosions and any ulcerations, defects has to be noted. And once you're done with that, the rest of the examination, like anterior chamber, iris, pupillary reaction becomes very important. You should look for afferent pupillary defect and relative afferent pupillary defect or absolute pupillary defect has to be noted. And this has to be monitored serially to identify the progression of the disease or the optic nerve. It indicates that there is a optic nerve compromise. Then look for a lens and anterior vitreous face. Once you're done with this, do a Schirmer's test. And intraocular pressure is very important, especially in any orbital mass where the pressure inside the orbit is increasing. So you get a there will be raise in the intraocular pressure. So that has to be measured in primary gaze as well as in up gaze. So in up gaze, it is just like using a applanation tonometer. The patient sits in a slit lamp. Using an applanation tonometer, just ask the patient to upward movement of the eye, then measure the intraocular pressure. So once it is done, you have to go for gonioscopy. After gonioscopy, you should dilate the look for the fundus. So apart from the routine distant direct ophthalmoscopy and using indirect ophthalmoscopy, you should also document in particular to orbit. You should look for pallor and disc edema or presence of any CEO, optico-choroidal shunts, and then in macula, you should look for the choroidal folds. So, and also some of the conditions like vein occlusions has to be noted, has to be looked for. Then once you're done with the fundus examination, some of the special investigations, like if the patient is complaining of diplopia, you should document a diplopia charting and a H charting. This is to follow up the patient and also to look for the prognosis of the condition, whether it is progressing or it is improving. And then if the patient is having a diplopia and there is a restriction of limitation of eye movement, you will have to do a FDT to rule out a restrictive or a paralytic condition. So you should never forget to measure, to examine the other system. ENT examination becomes very important in orbit. You should look for at least the anterior part of the anaerys, whether there is any mass or polyps or any tumors, and there is a deviation of the septum has to be documented. And once you're done with the ENT examination, look for the lymph nodes. Lymph nodes are very important, both in terms of infective cause, as well as any systemic lymphomas you can, or any tumor which is having a distant metastasis can be elicited by palpating the lymph node. So palpating a lymph node becomes very important. So you should palpate pre and post auricular, cervical and submandibular lymph nodes. Once you're done with that, never forget to examine the neck. So you should always look for a thyroid swelling. So based on all the investigation, history investigations, you will have to give a provisional diagnosis. So when you're giving a provisional diagnosis, always mention which eye, the side of the eye, whether it's a right sided or a left sided, axial or abaxial, eccentric proptosis, and also the degree, the severity, mild, moderate, severe has to be mentioned. Followed by that, you should mention the probable cause, like probably due to a thyroid orbitopathy or intraorbital mass. That has to be mentioned when you're giving a provisional diagnosis. So once you're done with the investigations, again, you'll have to look in for some of the blood investigations. Again, depending on the case, you'll have to select the investigations. So in a thyroid profile, you would do a T3, T4, TSH, and a thyroid receptor antibodies. And imaging becomes very important in orbital lesions. So CT and MRI is a must. Or an MRI is a must. So this is a clinical pro forma where you'll document the history, then you'll document the general status of the patient. Followed by that, you have a psychophysical examination, like indicating visual acuity, color vision, and whichever is possible, like visual acuity, color vision, and visual fields are must. And after this, again, you have the eyelids, whatever I said. So whether it is a pre-tarsal or preseptal or both involving either upper or lower, it is given a value of 0 to 3. So either preseptal or pre-tarsal, it is 1. If it is both, if it is either 1, 2, or if it is diffuse, then it is 3. And then again, chemosis is measured from 0 to 3. 0 to 3, again, gray line at the anterior lid margin and beyond that. And the rest of the things has to be like lid margin, interpalpebral fissure, MRD, clearance show, and the lag of thalamus, lid lag, if anything, some of the lid signs has to be mentioned. So after this, you should examine the, after eyelid, you should examine the orbit and do the exophthalmometry and do the, after the exam orbit, you have the motility. So motility can be either a Hirschberg, based on the Hirschberg's reflex, or a prism test can be done. This duction, post duction, I mentioned, like you can do it at the end of the examination. Then ocular biomicroscopy involving cornea and rest of the things. Then you'll have to give a diagnosis and then investigations, and you'll have to plan a management. So in a general orbital, any lesions involving the orbit, you'll have to take a proper history and ocular and systemic examination, followed by that you'll have a proptosis evaluation. Then you'll give a provisional diagnosis, consider imaging. Then based on the imaging, you can revise the provisional, you can revise the diagnosis. Then further added laboratory lab investigations. And then you should confirm it with a histopathology, either by an incisional or an excisional biopsy. This is for any lesion in the orbit, any mass. If you know, if you diagnose it with inspection, I mean with a clinical and radiological correlation, based on that, you will have to do an incisional and excisional biopsy and then confirm the diagnosis. And according to the confirmed diagnosis, you'll have to further plan the treatment. A special mention on thyroid, you should always include a BISA classification. There are various classifications like BISA and clinical activity score and EGOGO classification. So vision, again, there are subjective and objective. It's vision, color vision, and its progression. So vision and color vision is a subjective. An objective, you'll have to do a field center. You'll have to do a central field. And again, color vision, and then you'll have to look for the optic nerve and a presence of any choroidal folds. Depending on this, you can treat. If there is only a corneal changes, you can give a lubricating. If there is any compromise in the optic nerve, a compression of the optic nerve or edema, pallor, and choroidal folds, you'll have to consider the treatment. That is either steroid, IVE or steroid, radiotherapy, or a surgical decompression. So the second one is inflammation. In the BISA classification, you have the second part is inflammation. So any inflammation has to be managed with if it is moderate, you'll have to give a corticosteroids, either oral or a pulse steroid, and follow up the patient for every 6 weeks. If it is too severe and it is not responsive to treatment, you can go for a radiotherapy. And even if it is not responsive and it is progressing and severe, you can consider other modalities like immunosuppressives, or you'll have to go for a decompression. If it is compromised, if it is involving the optic nerve and a corneal nerve. Then the third component is diplopia. Again, diplopia, you should document whether it is intermittent or with gaze or constant. If it is intermittent, you can just closely follow up the patient. And if it is present in extreme cases, again, treat only when the patient, when the symptoms worsens. If it is present, if it is manifest and patient is having always throughout, you can, if it is an active case, active thyroid disease, you can give a temporary relief by giving a prednisolone. And if it is too severe, you can just give a conservative treatment and wait for the activity to resolve. Then you can plan for the strabismus surgery. And the last one is the appearance. So the appearance, again, look for lid and the proptosis. So lid and proptosis and other biomicroscopy has to be documented. So lid retraction, I don't mention about all these things. The importance of this is to classify, to know the activity of the thyroid disease. It becomes very important, and also for subsequent follow-ups and progression becomes very important. So until the patient is active, you cannot do anything for this. So once the patient is inactive for almost 6 months, then you can plan the other rehabilitative surgeries. So again, based on the BISA and clinical, there's another thing called clinical activity score, where you have a 10 features. And anything more than 3 to 5 indicates activity. Whenever there is activity, treat the patient with the appropriate oral or IV or steroids. Not resolving, go for a radiotherapy. I mean, low dose radiation can be given. And then if it is not resolving, then you can go for a decompression. Again, there are management in a case of a Graves orbitopathy goes like this. If it is mild, you can just give a selenium and wait for the thing to settle. And if it is progressing, then you can give a look for the steroids. That is either oral or IV, depending on the severity of the disease. If it is inactive to it, I mean, if the disease becomes inactive, then you can consider for a rehabilitative surgery. And if it is a severe sight-threatening, where it involves the optic nerve or the corneal exposure, then first thing, you can give a trial of IV or steroids. Followed by it, you'll have to wait for the response. If it is not responding, then you'll have to try for other things like a decompression has to be done. And if it becomes inactive, then you'll have to continue with if it's responsive to it, you'll have to continue with the steroids for further few more months, and you will have to follow. The rehabilitative surgeries, the order of it should be from addressing the proptosis, followed by that the strabismus, and then the eyelid. So it should follow this order.
Thank you very much, Dr. Usha. It's been a nice and comprehensive coverage for the entire evaluation for a patient with proptosis. Now, proptosis remains a very dicey case for most of the students taking the exam. The reason being that the questions can be enormous. They can come from any quarter, right? That's why it becomes very important to understand how to exactly go about with the evaluation when you have a patient with proptosis, so that the confusion is less when you come to a working diagnosis. And also you will have clarity in what you're going to convey to the examiner. I hope the evaluation techniques have been very clearly, because the videos were quite clear. The use of Hertels, the use of the double loops, and also all the other examination techniques were clearly shown in the videos. So I'm looking for any questions if they have any. And what do you think are the main, most more common mistakes which students make, Dr. Usha?
One thing is history should be complete, sir. Many a times there are many lacunes in history. And even when you're examining, like what I said, like palpation, how they palpate, like patient looking at the, when you're doing a finger insertion, all, no, they look down. And the position of the patients are not very appropriate.
Regarding the evaluation for patients in proptosis during exams, how important do you think that, because they may not have the Hertels, they may not have the loops.
Yes, sir.
So measuring with the scale, what are the small points they should take care of?
So again, measuring with the scale, so many a times what I've seen is the subject, the examiner sits in front of the patient and measures it. So there the examiner catch holds of the student that they have not done. So always sit lateral at the side of the patient, I mean side of the subject, and you will have to ask the patient to look straight, and the focus should be at a distance, at infinity, and you should sit at the same level as that of the subject. And place the zero end of the marking on the lateral rim, and then you'll have to look for the reflex, the corneal, the apex of the cornea, and measure. That will.
That's what is important, because the examiner will be sitting straight ahead in front of the patient and then asking. And if the student is also sitting straight and examining, that's when the examiner will take off. So these are small tips which I think everyone should be aware of. Especially when you're taking the exam and you have a patient with proptosis, be very careful. Usually proptosis is a very high scoring case. Unless you make very major blunders, most examiners actually tend to pass you when you get a patient with proptosis. Usually they do not go much into the management profiles. They just ask you the outlines of management. But yes, some investigations they may ask you as to what is a now gold standard investigation in most of the orbital cases, and always mention that it's a CT scan, not the X-ray. And regarding management, depending on the case, if it's a tumor, they'll want you to know the basic surgical approaches and the techniques. And if it's a case of thyroid, as the one that we were discussing in this, they want you to know the two major classification systems, that is the VISA and the CA system, and of course the UGOGO protocol of management. Just the outline is enough, especially in a VIVA exam, just the outline is good enough. And just the management outlines is also good enough for the VIVA. Well, that's what I can think of about proptosis, and I see that nobody has any questions to ask. So we'll bring an end to this session. Thank you very much, Dr. Usha.
Thank you.
Very nice. And for tomorrow's session, we'll be having a case discussion on glaucoma. It'll be a case of an open angle glaucoma, and it'll be presented like a case presentation with the moderation by one of our glaucoma consultants. And the session will be taken by Dr. Meena, who is a glaucoma consultant at Shankarai Hospital, Bangalore. The time remains the same at 12 o'clock. And see you all. Stay safe and goodbye.
Yeah.